Namaskar, very warm welcome dear learners. You are watching us live on PME Vidya channel, channel number 10 and on our NCERT official YouTube channel. I'm Renu Bhatt, welcoming you once again in this live phone-in session of CIET NCERT. And dear learner, in this session we are going to learn more about Researching Social Sciences Part 2. Last week we have done the same topic and session for 8th standard students, and we came to know why it's so important for students to do research in social science in schools. And let's meet our expert. You are Professor M.V. Srinivasan from Department of Education in Social Sciences, NCERT. Very warm welcome, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
And dear learner, this session is for 10th standard social science students. If you have any query, any doubts, feel free to contact to us. You can call us at our telephone number, that is 8800440559. Either you can drop a mail also at our email address, that is tth.class10@ciet.nic.in. And if you have joined through our live streaming, that means on our NCERT official YouTube channel, go to the live chat box and drop your comment out there. Our expert will be happy to answer all your queries and doubts. And if you have any experience, personal experience, do share your experience with us. And let me tell you a very interesting fact that we are accompanied by a young panelist, a couple of panelists with us. You are Mr. Kanishk Gokul from, you are in 12th class, and you are Miss Medha Bhatta from 9th standard from Shibuni School, Bengaluru. Very warm welcome to both of you. Kanishk, are you able to hear us?
Yes.
Are we audible?
Yes.
Okay. Sir, so without wasting much time, let's quickly come to you. And we would like to know more about the research portion in schools. Why do we conduct such researches?
Thank you, Renu. And first of all, let me thank CIT for giving this opportunity. My dear students, parents, teachers and other viewers, we all know that social science is an important subject taught in schools. When you were all very young, maybe in class 6 and 7, you may be wondering why all these things I have to learn. Why I have to learn about what has happened 5,000 years before? Why I have to learn something about the feet, what is there behind the feet, and so on. But when you become adolescent, when your parents go to buy vegetables like tomato, you may be wondering why tomato, which was 30 rupees yesterday, today it has become 150 rupees. You may be wondering why, right, when there is a political change and many streets, towns, like towns, their names are get changed actually. So for many of these concerns, for example, the COVID situation also taught us many things about the social sciences. So it is becoming, social science is becoming increasingly an important subject in our daily life. Whenever I conduct any training program with the teachers, one important question they ask me is that how to make social science interesting. My only answer is that I refer back to my National Curriculum Framework 2005, that if at all we want to teach any subject, including social sciences, it is necessary that we have to connect those areas with the life outside the school. What is happening in the society? That's the only suggestion I would say for you also. If you want to know more about this curriculum, please just go out and see how it is enacted in the whole of life actually. In my view, one of the important ways through which we can connect with the life is that experiential learning. Provide opportunities for children to conduct mini surveys, talk to people, experience the social dimensions of our life. What are the ways in which we can do? For example, we also see the National Education Policy 2020 recommends that we need to provide as much as possible experiential learning for children. So one of the ways, in my view, is that help the children to conduct small amount of research when they are in schooling stage. So if we want to conduct such studies, so the teacher were also how we can conduct the study. So I just participated in one small conference. Though it is small, it is an international conference. So I participated in the International Youth Geography Summit, which used to be held in Bangalore offline. But due to COVID, this time this conference took place in through online. So I participated in the conference. I found that the many children amazingly presented their papers in different areas of social sciences, and to be specific on geography. So I just thought that let us invite two students to participate to in our live forum and experience, like share their experiences. That's what we are going to do. In the last week also, those who are watching television for in studying class 8, you must have watched part 1 where two students from class 8 shared their experiences. And today we are going to have secondary level students, two students. So let me invite first Kanishk to share your experiences of a research study which you conducted and participated and presented in the International Youth Geography Summit conducted by the Institute of Geographical Studies. Kanishk, can you just share some of your views and your make a presentation about your research?
Okay, so I'll start presentation, right?
Sure.
So hello everyone, my name is Kanishk. I'm a grade 12 homeschooler living in Chennai. Today I'll be talking about how apps impacted our lives during COVID. So to begin this project, I decided to analyze the problem. There were a lot of physical restrictions imposed due to the pandemic. So this denied people the right to go around in search of supplies and time-critical care. To overcome this, people started using cyberspaces. As there's no physical movement in cyberspaces, people were able to overcome the various boundaries caused by COVID. Now, what is a cyberspace? A cyberspace is an online space created with the help of the internet. Any apps such as WhatsApp, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram will be part of the cyberspace. For this project, I used a questionnaire to gather data. Four categories of people were identified. Beneficiaries, these are the people who used apps to gather supplies. Benefactors, these are the people who referred supplies or gave supplies to people through apps. Then we have intermediaries, these are the people who connected beneficiaries and benefactors. Finally, we have the creator of a COVID app. In total, we got 23 respondents, 13 of whom were beneficiaries, 5 intermediaries, 4 benefactors, and we even got in touch with one creator. So beneficiaries, many of the beneficiaries mainly used Arogya Setu, WhatsApp and regular phone calls to communicate. Some of the beneficiaries even used apps such as DoctorLib and Telegram to communicate. Now, 6 of these beneficiaries were either COVID positive or cared for someone who was COVID positive. But only one of them faced a time critical need, which was to find out more about the virus and the precautions one had to take for against the virus. But more than medical need, it was noticed that many of them faced psychological challenges as they were all stuck in home and they couldn't meet friends and family members. Even if any family member passed away, they couldn't attend the funeral in person and console loved ones in person. Now, there were also other challenges faced by the beneficiary. Apps such as WhatsApp, Facebook were used to spread lies about COVID, COVID treatment and COVID vaccination. This allowed many people to fall for scams. And there were also bugs in apps such as DoctorLib that hindered user experience. Now we have the intermediaries. These are the people who used WhatsApp, regular voice call and Arogya Setu to communicate. Now many of the intermediaries got together and created an online network with benefactors using old connections. Now some of the challenges faced by the intermediaries were that they had to check if the beneficiary's request was genuine. This was because they didn't want to fall prey to scams. Two of the intermediaries had trouble adjusting to new apps. Now, for the case of migrant workers, the intermediary had to be careful not to cause a rift between the worker and the employer, as many employers refused to let the worker go home. Now, benefactors. Most of the benefactors used WhatsApp, Facebook, and Instagram. The benefactors helped in supplying food, financial aid, and medical aid. Now, the way the benefactors were able to reach remote areas was with the help of WhatsApp. Finally, we have the creator. Now, the creator we interviewed made an app for an NGO free of cost. It was noticed that the creator had used a pre-existing source code. This meant that there were apps pre-pandemic that were used in disaster relief. The app that the creator had made was available nationwide with around 750 users. Now, with this, we can make an app-person interface. A beneficiary can use an app to connect with an intermediary. And an intermediary can use an app to connect with a benefactor who can either provide individual assistance or an institutional assistance. Finally, we have a creator who can create apps, supply apps to the users, and make changes to the apps according to what the users say. So in conclusion, we have the real world and certain barriers posed by COVID. Then we have cyberspaces where there's no physical movement required and there is time-critical data transfer. So a data query or a data input can be sent from the real world into the cyberspace, and a data response can be sent back to the real world upon which action can be taken. So this is how cyber apps and cyberspaces impacted our lives during COVID. So with this, I end my presentation.
Thank you, Kanish. See, the social science is not only the history, geography, economics, and political science. It also can connect to the technologies that we are facing in our daily life, actually. Let me now invite the second student, Mehta Bhatta. Can you just present your findings, Mehta?
Yes.
We'll come back with the questions to Kanish. Please stay on.
Medha, are we audible to you?
Yes.
Yeah, please start.
Okay.
Go ahead with your presentation. Yeah.
I'm Medha. I'm in ninth grade and I study in Shibumi School. I'm going to talk about care during COVID from the perspective of my extended family. So I come from a South Indian family. Most of our family gatherings happen as a part of religious events. For example, pujas, annual death ceremonies, marriages, etc. This is the necessary background you will need to understand my study. As an example, how did they manage supposedly mandatory events such as shradhas, given these COVID restrictions? And so before COVID, we didn't have to think about care specifically. It happened very naturally. You know, external services such as maids, teachers, schools, and offices were not at a high risk zone, and therefore they helped us on a daily basis. However, all this changed completely when COVID arrived. External services have become a high risk, one that many people are not willing to take. They had to manage everything themselves, and therefore care became a deliberate action. This caused stress, specifically since COVID care meant a heightened responsibility for us and everybody around us. And we've noticed people were waiting for COVID to recede so that they could get back to what was normal, you know, as if it's even possible, because we've been in this for so long now. So I set off to find out who my extended family members were. I have a big family extending 5 generations, but I started off by making a family tree to assess if the functions were limited to first circle relatives due to COVID restrictions. It happened so that many got invited, but only few attended. The next thing I wanted to know was which events actually spread the virus and to what extent people were affected. I took help from close family members to find out what promoted my family to organize events and how invitees decided if they should go or not. This method allowed me to discover patterns. So here are some things I found out. There were 3 weddings. One wedding was a complete disaster. About 40 of my relatives attended it, and most got COVID. Bride also got COVID and was admitted to the ICU, and the parents, grandparents, everybody got it. Other events, thankfully nothing spread, but I also noticed that my older people in my family, they got COVID even when they didn't go out, because their kids or grandkids went to work or went to the bank and things like that, and they contracted the virus to other people. Initially, everybody followed the guidelines out of fear, but after the first wave was over, the data revealed 2 groups of people based on the risk they were willing to take. One group masked up and tried hard to minimize the spread of the virus. On the other hand, the second group started to let their guard down. This shows that each of us has a different understanding of what care means. Getting back to the 2 groups, I call them selective followers and diligent plus. Selective followers are those who only follow what the government guidelines are as rules, but their understanding is short, and so they follow those that do not come in their way. And if it's not to their convenience, then they won't follow it. such people have interesting justifications, such as, you know, how can I not go when they've personally invited me, or I'm vaccinated, so nothing will happen to me. Diligent plus are those who have adjusted and have to figure out how to live with these restrictions. They live, they work with the rules, even if it is an inconvenience to them. As you can see, when we don't attempt to understand the reasons behind the guidelines, we start to cut corners and just give these justifications as to why we do what we do. In the long term, we have all gotten tired of sitting at home, and so we find loopholes to free ourselves from confinement. Selective followers escape by attending social gatherings and events where they meet lots of people, while diligent plus go on vacations to minimize social interactions. Through my study, I've realized that when you care for yourself, you care for everybody around you. You know, for example, when you wear a mask, you're not only protecting yourself, but you're protecting everybody around you in case you have some, you have something. This concludes my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Mehta. It's very wonderful study, very different study, looking to the culture. In social science, it's called cultural geography. And you also find two different startup studies. Let me ask some questions to the students. And Kanish, can you just share your experience when you spoke to some more than 20 people, 25 people, around 23 people? Can you share how they responded to you, some of your experiences, how they reacted to your questions?
Well, at first, I felt that some of the questions people didn't answer, meaning I left most of the questions as an optional thing. So I think for them, it's a very new experience. And for me, it's also a new experience interacting with so many people online, meaning usually if I'm doing a research, it'll be a door-to-door research. But now that it was all online, it was very interesting to see how people responded, because I felt they had a bit more freedom, meaning communicating online than offline, because it's a nameless person. They just had to write the answers and they can just leave it at that. So it was a very new experience interacting with them, okay. I would say, with this new online method.
That's very important thing. Actually, when you conduct a study, you categorize people. It is the analytical, that's called analytical skills. When you talk to people and then divide them into four categories like beneficiaries, users, and so on, that shows that you are applying the analytical mind in your study, actually. Can you just share what is there for the students of social sciences from your study, in your own words, actually? How do you find that your study would be beneficial for social science students?
Well, I would say it's a new thing for social science students, because social science is essentially interacting with people. And right now, due to COVID, we have a completely new way to interact. So I feel with this study, people now realize how much online interaction is beneficial and how much impact it has on our lives. So using that, people can, you know, do a lot more research and figure out how deep the impact goes.
Thank you, Kanishk. And Mehta, just have some two, three questions to you also. How does your research connect to geography? Because this was presented in the International Youth Geography Summit.
Yeah. For, you know, anything in life, including this pandemic, place is very important. And geography is very concerned about space. When we study place, you automatically have to include economics, politics, and social structure, and human psychology. And so my research is part, and geography explores all of these things. So
okay. That's good. See, this kind of study of observing people by participating in these events, social events, that's also called ethnography. And it's part of the important area in social sciences. So many advanced level studies are conducted on ethnographic studies. Actually, your study is part of the, I would say that, part of the cultural ethnographic studies, actually, when compared with the survey-based study of Kanishk, actually. I just want to know, why did you choose this topic? Like, in what way, what inspired you?
I think I found it very interesting to see that there's social sciences even in our families and lives. You don't have to go to these big places to find, you can find it in your family and in your little circles. And even within your family, everybody reacts differently, and I found that very fascinating.
Oh, that's good. That's the very very motivational for our other young children who are watching this program. Do you plan to continue this study, like how extend this study further? I'm also wanting to ask this question to Kanishka also. How do you want to see this study in future, like when you are growing up, like are you following it up with the people? First, Mehta.
It's not avoidable. I care about my family, and so I want to keep up with what's going on, and that naturally is a part of what I have presented.
Yes. Kanishk, how do you want to follow it up, this kind of research? Do you think that there is a scope for doing this kind of study in future? Yeah. Also by you or anybody of your friends?
Yes, I definitely feel that will be the case, because apps and all these, though they have been an integral part of our lives, it's only now we are using them more and realizing their usefulness. So even post-COVID, however normal we get back to, it'll be very interesting to see how much the online life will play, because now that we have got used to it, and it's a very important part right now.
Thank you, helpful part. Thank you. And viewers, you can see how both the students have taken up two kind of research study. In one study, it is a survey based. You talk to some 25-30 people, whereas in the other research, you just closely observe weddings, parties, and see, take down notes on what is happening there, and then also follow it up with the people who participated in those gatherings, which I told you earlier, that's part of ethnographic study. So research studies can be conducted not necessarily by the surveys alone. And we also saw how in our last week program, how a student conducted a study in a park in Bangalore, how the pets, those who are growing, rearing, living with pets, how the pets got affected by the COVID, the impact of COVID on pets also we have seen in the last week class 8 program. And this is not the end, actually. Social sciences, different subject areas provide various opportunities for conducting a study, and it can be, many such studies are also conducted at different parts of India. And if you are having some interesting study by children of your school or your friends, and you can get in touch with us, and we can share this will be a platform for sharing your thoughts on how to do social science. See, social science research is not necessarily for submitting a project work. You know that in ninth and from class 6 onwards, many students are submitting projects as part of their social science. The 20 marks is allotted for the other than the pen and paper test, in which project is also submitted. So in that sense, actually, from class 6 onwards, you are getting exposed to the research in social sciences. And research in social science, from these two presentations, we also come to know that researching does not necessarily mean by only survey based. It can be like ethnographic research also. So you can also start taking your pen with you wherever you are going to participate in a party, maybe tomorrow or any other days or any other vacation, like social gatherings. You can take out your pen, your recordings, observe, talk to people, interact with them, and you can come back, prepare a report. That also becomes a major part of social science research. So variety of social sciences, when you conduct research, you are also become a critical thinker, because you come to know what is fact, what is not fact. You come to know what is true, what is not true. You also look at evidences. Are there sufficient evidences which says that your argument is correct? If there are no sufficient evidences, you can say that your argument is not correct. So your teacher also can help you in this regard to conduct interdisciplinary social science research in schools. With this, we are coming to again. Yes.
Yes, sir, but we still have a couple of minutes, and here I would like to ask you that in case any student want to do a research, what basic and important things he or she should get in their mind, sir?
One thing is that there are few things. Since social sciences includes history, geography, economics, political science, this is the only subject which gives you an interdisciplinary approach. Interdisciplinary means you can incorporate social issues, historical issues, geographical issues, political issues. So that is one. So social science provide opportunities for interdisciplinary research. So generally what I noticed in many schools that whenever teachers conduct or provide directions for doing projects, they follow certain procedures. The first is that they develop the title. Hmm. What is the title that they have to take? So title requires very careful thinking. Title also will help you to know whether is it possible to collect data, not able to collect data, what is the cause, what is the effect, what are going to be your tentative conclusions. So the title is the first step generally schools, classrooms, social science teachers decide in consulting with the students. And secondly, planning. You have to plan. If there is a, say generally 3 months, 6 months time is required for doing a project study, and not necessarily every day you have to spare time. So the planning is necessary. What I'm going to do first week, what I'm going to do second week. So teachers generally remind students that please have you finished the first stage. So the prepare the title is the first stage. And secondly, you have to prepare the methodology, how you are going to collect the data. What are the stages that you are going to do? So third step is the developing tools. So developing tools, it may be a questionnaire, it may be a set of questions, it may be interview schedule. So you can decide what questions I'm going to pose for answering the question in the title. Generally, most title, like a research project titles, are having some questions for which you as a researcher trying to answer, you as a researcher trying to find an argument, come to a conclusion. So the third step is tool development. And the fourth development, fourth stage is data collection. Okay. You have to collect data from the school, or it may be from the, within the school, or it may be you have to go out and collect data. That I told you that maybe ethnography or by the survey or going to the museum or going to the bank or many places, whatever the places, depending on the title, you have to choose and collect data. And fifth step is that you have to do analysis, how you can analyze the data. Okay, so after analysis, you can write the findings and show it to the teacher on regularly and then submit your project. These are some steps you can follow it up.
Exactly, these were the important steps that you have to keep in your mind while doing researching. And with this, we have come to an end in this session. So Kanishk and Medha, thank you so very much for joining with us, and all the very best from our side for your bright future. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And let me thank our expert also. You were Professor M. V. Srinivasan. Thank you so very much, sir. Yeah. You have come with us, you have joined with us, and you told us so many important things about the research. Thank you so very much, sir.
Thank you.
So, dear learners, with this, let me wrap up this session. But before wrapping me this session, let me tell you some important facts about the Rashtriya Kala Utsav. राष्ट्रीय कला उत्सव के बारे में हम आपको बता दें कि 1 से 12 जनवरी सन 2022 तक आप ये देख सकते हैं स्कूल शिक्षा और साक्षरता विभाग द्वारा शिक्षा मंत्रालय भारत सरकार की पहल पर NCERT के सौजन्य से 1 से 12 जनवरी 2022 तक कला उत्सव आमंत्रित किया जा रहा है और जो लिंक आपको अभी इस समय अपनी स्क्रीन पर दिख रहा है आप इस लिंक पर जुड़ सकते हैं और इस कार्यक्रम का आनंद उठा सकते हैं तो हम आपसे निवेदन करेंगे कि आप इस कार्यक्रम का हिस्सा जरूर बने और इसी के साथ मुझे रेणु भट्ट को दीजिए इजाजत नमस्कार